sins and griefs to bear.
Get this lesson underway. Do you have any comments about the lesson? What's the title of the lesson? What is it again? Gospel goal. The gospel's goal. How well did the lesson answer that statement or question, whatever you want to phrase it as? When I read the title of it, I assume that the lesson is going to be about the goal of the gospel. Is that what you assumed that it would be, or did you just read and not think? I guess when we just stop to talk about the title, the gospel of the goal, the ultimate gospel is salvation. That's why the good news is saved, so that people respond to the good news of God's love, His forgiveness, salvation being freely offered through Jesus Christ. But at the same time, that has to do with, there are two sides of the coin. One is Jesus as Savior. The other side of the coin is Jesus as Lord. What does that spell? Okay, so you could say that one goal of the gospel is for people's salvation. That's one side of the coin. The other object is Jesus, not just the Savior. Jesus as Lord. And I ask you a question, how well did the lesson answer that question? I'm not going to go on to one of my classic rants at this point. So, yeah, we'll believe it when we see it. But I felt like that's really, when they put these titles out there, they should really work to address it. And you can say, you can make the argument that they try to make that case with one of the goals of the gospel is to make people committed as a messenger. You know, the Apostle Paul was talking about his commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ as a messenger. And that has to do with the Lordship of Jesus Christ. When God calls you, saves you, He is also supposed to be the one that controls you. And He becomes, in a literal sense, your boss to tell you what to do. And if God calls you to serve, the teacher's book started out with a story about, I'll ask if you've ever heard of her before, Helen Rosevere. Could be Rosemary. Anybody ever heard about her? She was born in 1925 in Hertfordshire, England. Still haven't heard of her? She was raised by her father, who was a college professor. One day in Sunday school, her teacher told the class about missionary work that was taking place in India. In her heart, Helen committed to someday becoming a missionary. She later attended Cambridge University, where she earned her doctorate in medicine. Her call to missions continued to grow, and at a missionary gathering, she announced publicly her desire to go wherever God led, no matter what the cost. Later that night, she went to a mountain by herself to pray. She prayed that God would make her more like Jesus at any cost. She asked that he continue to do so even if she ever wanted him to stop, because in this prayer she was giving him the go-ahead to do so. So in March of 1953, that means that she was 28 years of age, she traveled to the Belgian Congo, later named Zaire, over in Africa, to serve as a medical missionary. She started a hospital and nurses training school in Ibambi, and later she transferred to run a maternity and leprosy center 7 miles away in Nebobongo. And it talks more about, in this thing, about her commitment. Where did that commitment come from? It is a fulfillment of the gospel's goal. The gospel's goal is not just to convert people, lead people to salvation. The goal of the gospel is to get people to commit to service of God. That has to do with the lordship of Jesus Christ. What we tend to focus on within our culture many times is salvation. Jesus is my Savior. We have kind of lost the perspective of what Scripture tries to teach. Jesus is not just your Savior. Jesus is also your Lord. That means that he has the rights to your life. He's the one that controls your life. He's the one that calls the shots. And this lady was basically committing herself, as Scripture encourages to, committing herself to be a messenger. It doesn't mean that you have to go to Africa in order to serve the Lord. But it means that you are willing, if God calls you, to go and serve wherever. I need to make this announcement in the worship service this morning. What does it say on the outside of this card? Lift. Yeah, you think it always looked like an E.
Yeah.
You can't see it from where you're at. It says lift. What is that about? You ever seen that before? Where? Well, lift up Jesus. But here within our association, we have a prayer team called Lift. That's the associational prayer team that comes and prays. We've been here to our church a couple different times. And those are women that have committed themselves. They go throughout the association once a month to a church. And they pray for the pastor. They pray for the church. They pray because they feel like they have been called as messengers. Do you know what? This card that I got this the other day from Liz Bale. Her husband, Clary, used to be the pastor down there at Friendly. And I'm not sure if they closed that church or not. But anyhow, Liz is on that team, and she sent this out. And she said, the Lift prayer team would like to invite you and anyone in your congregation to join us in Charleston, West Virginia on October the 28th. I think it's the 28th. The purpose of this trip is to join the Lift prayer team in praying with the 40 Days of Life organization. We will be praying outside the abortion clinic for the women who are going inside for an abortion and for the workers who work there. Come and join us in this project. Pray for the unborn child. We will be leaving the association office at 7 a.m. on October the 28th, if anybody's interested in joining. Why would they send that out? Why would anybody want to get in a car and ride 3 hours down to Charleston to say a prayer and get back in the car and ride 3 hours back home?
God blesses the vehicles.
And again, it may be worth it, but it's basically dealing with what the lesson is talking about today. The goal of the gospel is not just salvation. The goal of the gospel is to help develop within us the mind of Christ. And the mind of Christ is what? To seek and to save. those that are lost. So, you know, if you ask me about how the writers of the lesson, I just feel like many times they get bogged down in focusing on the trees. You know, they say you can't see the forest or the trees. They get to looking at the individual verses, and they don't do a good enough job of really stressing to people. The goal of the gospel is what? What's the title of the lesson? The gospel's goal is, I thought it said something, I don't know, spiritual transformation. Spiritual transformation, that's it. It means that it transforms us. It's not just saving us, but it transforms us into the likeness of Christ. So we're going to be looking at three things this morning. And I guess I make one other comment. If you look at the other 2 points, the first point of today's lesson is being committed as a messenger. It's one of the goals of the gospel, is that you and I would be committed as messengers. And it doesn't have to be to go downstate. Would we be willing to walk next door and invite our neighbor to come to church, the neighbor that we've never taken time to invite to come? We're messengers. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 21, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." If they, you know, you have to use your own discretion, but at some point in time you may feel like the Spirit urges you, well, offer them another invitation. You know? And I'm just saying that what the points that we're going to be looking at this morning is that the Apostle Paul was committed as a messenger. Why was he doing what he was doing? I mean, when you read over in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 what the Apostle Paul went through, why in the world did you abuse yourself? Why did you put yourself through that? Because the gospel's goal was that I might be like Jesus and concerned about those that are lost and be willing to go. Jesus said this, "I came not to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many." And this is what the gospel's goal is. And I'm just asking, give me some feedback. Is this what you got from out of the lesson? What I'm saying? If you got that out of the lesson, you did better than me, because I didn't feel like that was really what they were emphasizing. But when you put a title out there that this is what we're going to focus on, the goal of the gospel is to become like Christ. Yeah, the second point we're going to look at is focused on maturity. The one comment that I'll make about it is that now they don't really give you any examples here. Or if they do, it's not as thorough as I need to be. How do you know when you've become mature? Let me ask you a question here, almost because he's not here.
What?
Does a turtle ever think that he's mature?
He probably does. Thinks he is.
Shouldn't be talking about him when he's not here. What do we classify as maturity? When you're basically ready to take care of yourself.
On your own.
Now, there's different things that you and I can be mature on and so on and so forth. But, you know, the lesson really doesn't talk about the measurements for maturity. How can you tell if you are really becoming mature in Christ? What are the key elements? You know, they could have been drawing from the Apostle Paul's life of, well, these are signs that a person has really become more mature in Christ. But the lesson.
Well, I think when you start the church, you know, first you just go. You know what I mean? I mean, some just go to see the friends or whatever. But then as you get, you start maturing because you want to be there. You want to learn.
And that's
then
a
the
good.
The more you learn, the more mature you get.
It's easier to go.
Well, it's easier to go, and it's not only that, you want to go because you're hungry for the Word.
Yeah.
And there's growth that's taking place.
Right.
And you're seeing changes, and other people are seeing changes. But I'm just saying that for me, the lesson doesn't really address these things. If we're going to be talking about the goal of the gospel, then let's put some, you know, flesh on it. You've given us a great outline here. And so I'd like for us to talk, if we get a chance, to talk about what are signs of maturity. And then the last one is concern for the faithful.
I think the more you get into things and start reading, you know, the more you understand. I understand more now than I did years ago.
And that's good.
And a lot of people, they just go to church and sit and, they think they're okay because they went to church.
I'll disagree with you on one thing. A lot of people don't go to church anymore. Said a lot of people don't go to church.
some of them just go
three times a year.
Yeah, they don't go very often, but I think they still believe, but they just can't talk themselves into getting up and going to church. And like I left my daughter and her husband at home because she just can't be around a lot of people because her
immune system
resistance is so low. And she walks a little bit. And, I mean, she does a few things, and she tries to put on like she's feeling great, and then she falls apart. But she don't have no energy. She's not Vicky right now. So
and that's what cancer
in bed and her husband.
Yeah, they drove down.
I didn't know that, but that's what cancer and stuff. And I'm completely understanding.
Yeah, her cancer's fine, but that flu that she had or whatever it wasn't COVID, but I think it was worse because she was in the hospital a whole month except for a day.
Yeah, yeah.
And she's still, and the doctor said it'll take her about 6 months at least to get back her energy. And,
okay.
Because she used to be so full of pep and energy, and I've been with her a few days, and I see how, but when she's out with the rest of them, she, you know, puts on like she's happy-go-lucky and all, but when she's just with me, you know, I don't let her do anything.
Well, we've got a lot of people right now,
so,
I shouldn't say a lot, I'm using the same words, but...
She said when she got out of the hospital, if she walked, say, from here to where you're at, she might pass out. She just didn't have the energy to move. Mm-hmm. And she may have a little bit of lupus, too, because that's what her dad had. And that's the way he was. He would go out, and a half hour or so later, he'd come in and couldn't hardly get into the house. And he was just so wore out doing nothing. And that's the way she is right now. And I told her, I said, I'll bet you have lupus. And she said, yeah, they said I did. So,
okay. I'm glad she was able to come visit you. And I know you as well.
Her husband drove the whole way.
Okay.
And but I just leave her. She sits and lays. And
we're glad that you were able to come. And we pray that she'll be okay. And that y'all have a great visit together. Yeah. We really do.
They're going to be here for the week. And then he'll drive back home and go back to work on Monday.
Okay.
It's good to see him.
Absolutely.
And then she'd been on the steroids and stuff, and she's gained a lot of weight on top, you know, how they bloom out.
Yeah.
And she can't get rid of that, so I said, don't worry about it, but, you know.
Well, enjoy the times we have together.
She don't want to be around too many.
Yes,
know.
Yes. So anyhow, I know that I spend a lot of time on the introduction, but I kind of get the feeling at times with these lessons, they just put titles on the stuff, and then they really don't follow up and try to teach us what the title is about. And the title today is, because all month long, and I guess next month too, we're talking about the gospel. Today we're talking about the gospel's goal. And as I've said already in my opening remarks and repeated since, the goal of the gospel is not just salvation. The goal of the gospel is growth, and growth happens as a result of the lordship of Jesus Christ, that the Lord is the one that controls your decision making. And you and I have a responsibility to not just, a lot of people, they just want Jesus as their Savior. They don't want Him as their Lord. And I'm telling you, it's two sides of the same coin. There's one coin, and it talks about in the Scripture of Jesus as Savior and Lord. Not Savior or Lord, but Savior and Lord. And He is supposed to be the one that's in charge of us. So the first passage of Scripture we're going to look at is that we're going to read about the Apostle Paul being committed as a messenger. And it begs the question, why is the Apostle Paul committed as a messenger? Because the gospel compels him. The good news of God reaching out His love to him compels him. You know the Apostle Paul, right? The love of Christ constrains us. It compels us. It's one of those things, I feel an obligation. You know, I think in one of the two lesson books, it talked about the Apostle Paul when he was on the road to Damascus and he had his conversion experience. And God said to him, you know, I'm going to basically put you through some real suffering yourself. You're going to have, that's not the exact words, but I've got some stuff down the road that you're going to have to go through. But listen, it's what's necessary. And the Apostle Paul is going to kind of mention that in this passage of Scripture, that it's kind of filling up what Christ, His sacrifice, maybe He had not accomplished. I hate to phrase it that way, but the Apostle Paul, why is he serving as a messenger? Because of the gospel.
The good news.
Changed his mind, but also he was excited about what Christ has done. And that's one of the main thrusts of the lesson. I want everybody else to know, because the Apostle Paul would end up saying along with Peter over in the book of Acts, salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men
whereby
we must be saved.
We want our families to all know Jesus, and we want our friends to all know Jesus.
Right.
And
that's why he's a messenger. And that's what the lesson is trying to get across to us. The goal of the gospel is that you and I might be messengers, committed as messengers as well. And I don't know how much, you know, the lesson really communicated that to you. I certainly didn't get it really strongly communicated to me. But that's the point that's being tried to make. Sheila, would you like to read the first passage for us, please?
Sure.
Okay.
Committed as a messenger. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for you, and I am completing in my flesh what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for His body, that is the church. I have become its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to His saints. God wanted to make known among the Gentiles the glorious wealth of His mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Okay, look at that 25th verse. What does it say? He's talked in the first, the 24th verse about I'm rejoicing in sufferings, but I'm completing the flesh with my Christ's afflictions for His body, that is the church. Verse 25.
Yes,
I have become His servant. According why? According to God's commission. Earlier, just a couple minutes ago, I quoted Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. Jesus said what? Go ye therefore. What is that known as in Scripture? Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father. What is that known as?
Great Commission.
The Great Commission. Yeah, that's what it's known as. And who was Jesus saying it to? I'm saying it to my followers. I've commissioned you. You see, the gospel's goal wasn't just to save us. We were saved to serve.
Is that our goal from the very beginning?
That's what it should be, but that's why we have this lesson, because a lot of people don't get it. They don't understand. They think, well, the only reason I was saved was so I could go to heaven. And that's why we go to this lesson and we read in the Apostle Paul's words, look, folks, I was commissioned. And he doesn't say it as much, but you and I bringing out to you Matthew chapter 28, where Jesus said, as he was speaking to his followers before he goes back to heaven, he says, look, go ye therefore.
That's not a great comfort, because I always buy some little dog. That's what I
would think.
I'm watching
all the dogs. And sadly, I'm guilty too of not being outspoken, but we need to remember this is why we come together and we study the Word of God, because the Word of God says, look, the goal of the gospel wasn't just your salvation. The goal of the gospel was to help you grow to serve Christ better and serve Him more. And many times we haven't done what we need to do as far as spreading the gospel. He says in the 25th verse, I become a servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you. God wanted me to come and witness, you know, I'll say this again about Colossians, we talked about this last week. He had never been in this church apparently. But it didn't keep him from caring about it. Here he is in prison. He writes a letter to them. And again, we talked before about Paul was writing this from Rome in prison. Policy wasn't over in Philippi. We set a distance to Philippi, over there to Rome where he was, 1,200 miles. This was a lot further. This was pure over Turkey. And he wrote this letter and he had to make arrangements for somehow that letter that he had written to be given to this church. He also wrote at the same time a letter to the church at Laodicea. Those two communities were very close together. And he even says, after you folks here get through reading this letter, pass it on to the church at Laodicea and read what I wrote for them. I don't know how much he might have had to pay in order to have somebody to transport them. But he had a burden for them. And what this lesson is trying to teach us is that God's goal with regard to, you know, the gospel wasn't just to save us, but it was so that we could be servants and help to lead others to faith in Christ. Why are these ladies once a month taking time out of their schedule to travel all over? Because the message of the gospel is, it's not just about me going to heaven. It's about working to do what I can to help others get to heaven as well. And the Apostle Paul is saying, but the gospel's goal was to help make you and I committed as messengers. I can't save anybody, but I can tell them how to be saved. I can point them in the right direction. Verse 26, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to the saints. Now, there was a time that we didn't understand all this, but the Apostle Paul says, you know, now we understand what God's plan is. God's plan is that, really, He wants everybody to be saved. I honestly believe that. God wanted to make known among the Gentiles the glorious wealth of this mystery. The Jews have thought, oh, the Gentiles, God doesn't want them to be saved. And Paul said, no, that's totally false. God wants the Gentiles, the people of Colossae, they're Gentiles. They're not Jews, they're not from down in Jerusalem. And he says, the glorious wealth of the mystery, what's the glorious wealth of this mystery? The glorious wealth is Christ in you. It's when Christ comes in you, and all of a sudden you're changed in the likeness of Christ. It's, when I say all of a sudden, it's not complete. It's not like you become Christ overnight. It is a growth process. No. And the Apostle Paul acknowledged that in his own personal life. Not that I've already attained, but I keep pressing on. If I were just to pause here right now and ask this the question, committed are we as prosecutors? What kind of a grade would we give ourselves?
Yeah. Okay, D minus.
And I'm not asking us to beat ourselves up, but again, this is what lessons should be. And many times I just feel like the lessons are just trying to give us information. I read a book. It was actually one of those books that my buddy Mark Parker, the guy from down in Kentucky, who sent me about revival. I told you that I met him like 30 years ago. And he had a quote in there in one of the devotional things that I read that said that there was I take that he was a somewhat famous preacher. I don't even remember the guy's name. But this preacher had traveled around, and he said it really bothered him when he went to churches around America. Because he said, when I go to the churches, I hear lots of information, but I don't hear preaching. And then in this devotional that Mark wrote, he explained what the guy was saying. The guy was saying, many times people come there to learn, to get smarter, but they're not motivated to do anything. Preaching motivates to do. And the goal of this lesson isn't to just sit back, as the book of James says, well, I guess so, I can see that I'm really not being much of a messenger. And then not do anything about it. James says about it, you look at yourself in the mirror, you see what you ought to be, but you don't do anything about it. You just kind of go on your way. And James says that's why you and I need to be doers. We need to kind of make a list of maybe this week. Maybe this week I can invite one person to church. I know Chuck all the times when he's up there by the pulpit. You know, invite somebody to church. Because why? Why are we doing it? Because the gospel's goal wasn't just the same as the gospel. You have been a messenger. You've been a messenger. You are committed to being a messenger. I'm going to do what I can. I can call. I know that you said you've called up people on the telephone to check on. That's wonderful. Send them a card. That's wonderful. Why do we do that? Because we realize we have not just been saved to go to heaven. We have been saved to serve the Lord. And we need to be committed as messengers. Lord, do you want to use me as a messenger? God says, sure, I can use you as a messenger if you're willing to be used. A messenger is somebody who just carries a message.
Not only to be a messenger, we are to carry ourselves as someone
that
truly loves God
from
the bottom of our heart.
Absolutely.
Because there's always somebody that watches. Why did they commit themselves to the messenger? Because the goal of the gospel wasn't just to save you. The goal of the gospel was to get you and to use you for the Lord's service. And see, I don't mean to beat up the writers, but I didn't get this impetus from the lesson. I get a lot of explanation about what this sentence means and what this word means and so on and so forth, but I don't get that they really try to stress to the listeners, our class, they didn't really try to stress, look, folks, the gospel's goal is that you can be used, and you can be. You say, well, I don't have a PhD, I don't have all this, down there. You're just a messenger. You're not asked to do all that. All that you're asked to do is deliver the message. And what the people do with the message, that's going to be up to them. Absolutely. It comes through, whether you're genuine. Absolutely. So the second point of today, comment there also? No? Okay. Second passage of Scripture today,
What is a secondary goal of the gospel? What is the heading? Focused on maturity. The goal of the gospel is that you and I might become mature in Christ. And again, I didn't think that the lesson gave us a lot of specifics about what does it mean to be mature in Christ. Mary, would you like to read this second passage for us? I want to please thank you.
We proclaim him, warning and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. I labor for this, striving with his strength that works powerfully in me.
Okay. And not to bore you, and I know there's people that they watch us on video, we've got a lot of people. But to use what I'm, and I could have done this in the first section too. Look at the bottom of your page there on page 77. You get an explanation there on what? His message includes both warnings and teachings. A warning just implies that you're doing something wrong, and if you don't stop, you're going to suffer the consequences. And teaching means it's going to teach you how to do it right so that you don't get a warning. Okay. So you got that explanation. The next part, if you turn to the next page, it talks about wisdom. Wisdom means seeing things from God's perspective and acting according to his plan. The presence of false teachers made God's wisdom even more important than the Colossians in their context. Why am I going through all of this? Because I don't feel like that they gave us examples of what does it mean if we're supposed to be focusing on maturity. What does it mean to be mature in Christ? This is another goal. It wasn't the goal of the gospel was to, first of all, be committed as messengers. The second goal would be for us to become mature in Christ. And where is the explanation of what it means to be mature in Christ? What is maturity in Christ? If you were to describe for me, what does it mean to be mature in Christ?
Trying to be more like him.
I don't know if it's ever reached.
But what are some signs that you can say that you're seeing maturity in Christ? I know that Janet brought up just, and I'll come back to you. She brought up, well, you begin to understand I need to be in church.
Right, devotion.
When you become old enough to recognize I am no longer a child that can live on Kool-Aid and crackers. You know, when you reach an age that you understand, look, if I am going to be living on my own, I'm going to have to eat. And I better make sure that I get myself fed. And sadly, within the Christian community, there's a lot of people that end up, they are completely immature because they think, I can survive without food, mm-hmm. spiritual food.
Yeah.
Yeah. Am I right or wrong?
You're right.
What are other signs of spiritual maturity? You started to say something else. I cut you off. Didn't mean to.
No, you're fine. I said devotion.
Devotions. Yeah. And really, every day, it's not about just coming to church once a week.
Right.
It's about spending time with the Lord. You begin to realize the Lord is the one that I'm dependent on.
Right.
I need him. And your focus then becomes, I need to, and we never do become fully mature, but I need to grow even more.
The secular world becomes different. You know, you're more drawn to the Lord. You don't want to get into more of the secular stuff, like on, I don't know, TV, radio, that kind of stuff. You don't want to hear it anymore.
There are those things that can draw us away from what we should be doing.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like the kid that stays up late at night and he realizes he's either got to be at work tomorrow or he's got to be in school. It's immature. Mm-hmm. You got to understand there are priorities, and we're living within an age that many times people have sacrificed the priorities. They give up what's most important for what they want the most.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're not satisfied. They're not happy.
Right.
No. And I said that earlier, not pick on Turtle. I like Turtle.
We love
but
Turtle.
I raised the question. You know, because I tell you what, there's a lot of people out there that really aren't mature enough to be living on their own.
It's getting worse.
Decisions that they make.
Yeah.
Maturity means that you and I have become old enough and really wise enough to kind of care for ourselves. And that doesn't mean that we're leaving the Lord out. It means that we understand we need the Lord. I sent Miss Bessie an article the other day. You do realize that there's a shipping problem out in California?
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. And you do realize they say that it's going to create monumental problems as you go into Christmas season. There's a lot of problems on the horizon and whatnot, and it's I could go not all day, but I read all this stuff. Anyhow, we've got a shortage in America right now of 80,000 truck drivers. 80,000. Because they're going to have to get this stuff once it gets to port and they manage to get the stuff unloaded and whatnot.
Our teenagers to drive the trucks.
And that's where I was going. What did they say the other day? There was an article that said that they're trying to lower the age that a truck driver, because right now it's 21 years of age, they're trying to lower it down to 18. And I sent the article to Miss Bessie and I said, that doesn't sound like a good idea to me. And she said, that sounds like a good idea. Why do you say that? Why?
Because they're not
mature. Their legs can't reach the pedals.
Not mature enough.
Well, they're not mature in their thinking. Like, I mean, when you're in your early 20s, you don't think like you do now, right?
They're desperate,
you know.
It's not just that. There are other things that you know, we've put age restrictions on because we want the person to be mature. We want the person to be of age that they can really make good, solid decisions.
Well,
and there might be some out there that are qualified.
Yeah, I got grandkids that's in their 30s or 40s, and they're still not mature.
Well, husbands that ain't mature.
Got a husband that ain't mature sometimes.
But again, yeah,
I don't have the husband.
We could say that but there are standards that really need to be followed. You know, I don't need to open up this can of worms, but Alex Baldwin, you know, big time against, you know, Second Amendment rights and so on and so forth. He's on a movie set, and I feel bad for him and the families and whatnot. But
live gun there.
They were using it as a prop. But one of the things that you learn if you're a gun owner is that you don't aim guns at people.
Right.
And you certainly don't ever put your finger on the trigger unless you're planning to use it. Mm-hmm. And he followed none of these things. Mm-hmm. And I would say, you know, that's immaturity.
Yep.
It may have been just ignorance on his part, but you showed by your actions you are not mature enough to be handling a weapon. Because one of the things, if you work with kids in teaching them about firearms, you teach them safety. From the beginning, you know, a gun is not something that when we were kids playing with, you know, toy guns, it was one thing, but when you got a real gun in your hand, you never pointed at somebody else. Mm-hmm. And like I said, not to open again, I'm using the illustration of maturity. You've got to understand that there are responsibilities that come along with what you have. And when you become a follower of Jesus Christ, one of the responsibilities that you have is that you need to not only take care of yourself, but you should grow to the point that you can take care of others. That's what the Apostle Paul was busy doing. And sadly, I probably don't need to go down this road, but I'm going to go down this road so y'all pull me out the ditch if I end up bleeding and hurt. We got a lot of people within our churches that they never mature past infancy and childhood. They can't even take care of themselves spiritually, let alone take care of somebody else. What do you mean by that, preacher? They have to be taught everything. They never reach an age that they can end up teaching others. Maturity is when you can take care of yourself and you can end up helping others as well. What did the Apostle Paul say? We proclaim him, warning and teaching everyone with all wisdom so that we may present everyone, what? Mature in Christ. I want to grow to the point that I can help to take care of others. I want to know the Word of God enough that I don't have time to have to go running to the preacher or something like that. Not that I'm opposed to it. I want you to always feel free to come. And there are still things that I don't know. So, you know, I still am asking questions. But sadly, many within our churches, they never go to the point past, I'm going to go to the church and sit there for an hour and hear what the preacher has to say. And that's the sum total of their growth as a Christian. That is not maturity in Christ.
It's laziness.
If not laziness, I think it's fair to say it's immaturity. Mm-hmm. Because you basically, I hate to use an illustration because this seems so demeaning. You basically want to be the baby that lays in the crib and has a bottle handed to him for the rest of their life. Mm-hmm. And that's not what the gospel's after. The gospel's after maturity in Christ. That you and I can go out. You know, you and I say, I can't do that. Who was it that Jesus called to be his followers? Did he call the brightest and the most educated? No, he just called regular people, fishermen. And you know the amazing thing? He said, you guys, you may doubt it, but I can make you fishers of men. And those 11 guys, with, of course, the empowering of the Holy Spirit, because you and I are nothing without the Holy Spirit. Those 11 guys turned the whole world upside down. Mm-hmm. It's maturity when you begin to understand, you know what? It's nice kind of being fed, but that's not where God wants me to stay. God wants me to use me. And I can. I'm going to tell you something as your pastor. You will absolutely learn more by teaching others than I will ever be able to teach you. Because what it will do is make you dependent upon the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is such a better teacher than I'll ever be. And as you walk leaning on the Lord, you will grow leaps and bounds. That's a sign of maturity. That's one of the goals of the gospel. That you and I might grow to be mature. Maturity is when you can take care of yourself and you can help take care of others. I made her cringe earlier. I asked if Turtle was ready to take care of himself. Now I'll make her cringe even more. Do you think he's ready to even take care of others? Would you recommend turning over an entire children's home to him? Why'd you laugh? Not to pick on him. The rest of us, we might cringe a little bit if we get that awesome responsibility.
But you could be surprised what he could do.
He keeps
and you'll be surprised what you can do with God's help.
He could probably do it.
And I won't disagree, but if a person has to walk with the Lord and depend upon the Lord. And you're going to need the Lord's help. The last point of today's lesson. Who would like to read the last passage of Scripture out loud for us, please? Which applied that?
Well, I want you to know how very I am talking to you. For those who...
They all see it.
They all. And for all who have not seen me in person, I want their hearts to be encouraged and grown together in love, so they might have all their lives and have the knowledge of God's Christ. In him, I get all of the
okay, so what does he start here? This second chapter, verses 1 through 3. I want you to know how greatly I am struggling. Here's the last point of today's lesson. The goal of the gospel is that you and I might have a concern for the faithful. Yeah, we're supposed to be concerned for the lost, but the Apostle Paul is struggling for these believers. They are the faithful ones. They are the ones that are given to Jesus. And so, what does that mean for us? There is a concern for the body of Christ. And I'm going to beat on a drum that may not need to be beat. But when our churches are empty, what it's saying by those that aren't here, and I understand that there are people that aren't coming right now because of COVID, and I'm not speaking to that. But you know as well as I do, before the whole COVID thing, our churches were already suffering. What it is saying is, those that aren't here, unless there's, you know, some other reason, and most of the time, I'm going to go out on a limb, most of the time there is not a reason for the majority of people out here, and you can send me hate mail or whatever. But I think that you could go throughout the community and knock on the doors, and there'd be people in the community that could be at the house of the Lord this morning, but they're not, and they weren't here last week, and they weren't. There isn't a concern for the church. There does need to be a concern for the lost, but there also needs to be a concern for the church. The Apostle Paul says, I want you to know how much I'm struggling for you. I am concerned, genuinely concerned, for the body of Christ. Well, and it may not be that they don't fear the Lord, but my main point is that there really isn't a concern for any of us. And I'll tell you what, I don't want to overstate the importance of the churches, but I, from what I understand, Alex DeCoco, he was a historian, I think it was from over in France, he came to the United States find out what it was, how it was that America became so great in such a short amount of time. I mean, we came from nothing. So, you know, from the time that the pilgrims ended up landing here back in 1620 to by the end of the Revolutionary War, where we got our independence, we in that short amount of time became greater than all the other nations in the world. This guy, Alex de Tocqueville, he comes over here trying to find out what it was that made us so outstanding. How in the world did this happen? So he traveled throughout America and went back and he wrote a book. I forget the title of the book. What were the conclusions that he came up? It was the faith of the people, which was grounded in the Word of God. He said, from what I've never read the entire book, I'm going by what David Barton has ended up saying, that as he went throughout America, he stopped in town after town and he saw the influence of the church. The influence, the way that it impacted the people within the community. The church was the place that taught morality. It was what taught right and wrong. It taught a dependence upon God. It taught those things that were absolutely fundamental. The strength of the family. You know, the family was something to be protected and guarded. And the church was so instrumental in making America so. He went back and wrote this long, long book. But the basic thrust of it was, America is great because of her faith. And the role of the church in its faith in the life of the nation. Isn't it interesting that we're seeing within our society today issues of homosexuality, transgenderism, you've got abortions, you've got defund the police, you've got critical race theory that's being more divisive. It's not one bit interested. Critical race theory is not one bit interested in trying to bring people together. It's about creating more division. And when you begin to look at all of this stuff that's going on in America, you end up saying, well, I wonder how this happened. And I come back to my argument. It's happening because the condition of the church. You see, when Alex de Tocqueville made his trip around America back then, he would go into church after church and he would find lots of people. He would see people at the altar praying. He would see people giving their hearts to Jesus Christ because they understood. Following Jesus wasn't just about getting saved. Following Jesus was about serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And it made a difference in the people of America. And America, just like ancient Israel, has given up. America has given up on God, just like ancient Israel. When we no longer assemble ourselves together to hear what God has to say, we have turned our back on God. There needs to be a concern for the faithful. That's why the Apostle Paul was writing. I understand the gospel. The goal of the gospel was about reaching other people. Yeah, I got that. I understand it was about maturity, helping people mature, but it's also about caring for the flock. And that caring for the flock means to everybody. It's not, oh, pastor, did you go check about so-and-so? What about so-and-so? I'm not opposed to you asking me, but please understand, the concern shouldn't be just me. The concern should be from the entire church. There's no way that I can keep up with everybody. So, I don't mean to end on a facetious note. You can slap me as I leave, but aren't you glad that you got all that from out of the greeting that was? I say that, and I do appreciate the writers, but many times I wish that they would stop just trying to educate and inform and start preaching. This is what we need. The gospel's goal. The gospel's goal. Alright? Let's have a closing prayer. Father, I thank you for your word today, and thank you for the lesson, and pray, Father, that you will help us to take it to heart. Many times it's just comfortable to know that we're going to heaven and feel like that that's sufficient. But the goal of the gospel never was just to get us to heaven. The goal of the gospel is that we might grow and become like your son and learn to serve and care for the church and to reach lost people. And I pray, Father, that you might help to make us those messengers, that we might place within our heart a burden for each other. More than anything else, that we might mature to the point that we too can reach others so that they will come to know you. Bless us, bless us to our lives and us to your service. Have your will in the way you can serve us to follow and use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.